Hello, friends. I want to personally welcome you to Christ Church Howell, a church dedicated to worshiping God, empowering people, and reaching the world. Today, as I share powerful truths from the Word of God, I pray you will be lifted up and transformed, that you will purpose in your heart to not only walk in all that God has destined for you, but that you will also impact everyone else around you. I believe God has a word for you, so join me.
Father, we come to give your name praise. We come to call out and shout your name in the name of Jesus. Father, when we call on your name, things have to change. When we call on your name, there's healing that takes place, Father. When we call on your name, there's power that is released out of heaven. So, Father, we thank you. We give you glory and we give you honor.
Call your name, it's something we cannot explain that happens when we proclaim your great name, your great name. We love to call your name, it's something we cannot explain that happens when we proclaim.
Wait!
When we call your name,
things change. have victory when we call upon your name. For there is power, there is power, there is power, there is power, there is power in the name of Jesus. Oh, hey, and there's a shifting when I call. Situation. It has to change when I call. And mine is transformed when I call. And there is wisdom when I call. I'll do it one more time. And there is victory when I call. And there is healing when I call. And there is power, power. And there is power, power.
Worthy is the King who conquered.
I sing for all that you've done for me. This is amazing grace. Oh yeah, amazing grace. Amazing grace. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. All that you've done for me. There is victory. I came here, God, to lose myself in your presence, that you may pour out your spirit and fill us up once again, Father. We give you glory, we give you honor, and we give you praise.
Into your glory.
Remove the pride that you hate. Oh God, remove the pride that you hate so much within us, oh God. Humble us. Hallelujah, Father. Change us, Father. I want you to change people, Father. Transform people, Father. Salvation, Father. Redemption, Father. Oh, I need you, Lord. Father, we thank you. We thank you for hearing our prayer. We thank you, Father, that you didn't throw us away, oh God. We thank you, Father, that you saw past our need, saw past our sin, Father, and saw our need, Lord. We thank you, Father. We thank you, Father. I need you. Oh, I need you. I need you, Lord. I need you, Lord.
Oh, how we need the Lord. I'm so glad to be with you this morning. Worship was wonderful. Being in the presence of God is delightful. And this morning, I want to invite you to just come on in, sit down, that we might hear what the Lord has to say in this environment. I want to share with you a message this morning that I've entitled, It's Time for Something New. Let's pray. Lord, how we give you glory and honor, and how we declare that it is you that we need. It is you that we're desperate for. We pray, God, that you would speak today, that we who are here have ears to hear, so speak, have a heart to receive, so speak. God, do what only you can do. Let your word go forth and accomplish, Lord, that in which has been ordained by heaven. Speak to us, change us, strengthen us, renew us, transform us, God. Do what only you can do. We thank you for this. In Jesus' name, amen. As I look at the suffering caused by COVID-19, systemic racism, cultural indifference concerning God, and the lukewarmness of believers, my heart's cry to God is, Lord, how do we change the trajectory of our world? It can't be church as usual. It can't be life as usual. I know there are some simply wanting to return to the things of old. There are some saying, can't we just go back to normal? But I want you to know something. Going back to the familiar will not do. But what if, just what if, God has allowed this disruption, this crisis, to move his people from one place to another place? What if God has allowed what is going on in our world that he might get our attention? What if, just what if God is saying enough is enough, that the old will not do anymore? It's time for something new. Is it possible that God is saying just that. It's time for something new. I want you to turn with me, if you would, to 1 Kings, the 18th chapter. And we'll be reading from verses 41 to 45. Again, that's 1 Kings, the 18th chapter, beginning at verse 41 through 45. Then Elijah said to Ahab, "Go up, eat and drink, for there is the sound of an abundance of rain." So Ahab went up to eat and drink, and Elijah went up to the top of Carmel. Then he bowed down on the ground and put his face between his knees and said to his servant, "Go up now, look toward the sea." So he went up and looked and said, "There is nothing." And seven times he said, "Go again." Then it came to pass the seventh time that he said, "There is a cloud as small as a man's hand rising out of the sea." So he said, "Go up, say to Ahab, prepare your chariot and go down before the rain stops you." And it happened in the meantime that the sky became black with clouds and wind, and there was a heavy rain. So Ahab rode away and went to Jezreel. Let me give you a little backdrop as to what was going on during these times. Ahab was considered a wicked king. Him and Jezebel was ruling, but they were wicked. The people of Israel was doing what was right in their own sight. And the Bible used the man of God Elijah to declare that there was going to be a drought. There was going to be a drought, and they would know that surely that the God they were worshiping, Baal, did not rule, nor did he reign. These people were doing things. Their faith wasn't in God. Their heart wasn't turned towards God. All that they was doing did not honor God. What they were doing was pleasing self, was pleasing their own imagination, their own hearts. Whatever they wanted to do, they were doing. As a result of that, there was a national crisis. God said, "There's going to be a drought. This is what you want to do. I'm going to back up. Do what you want to do." And we find out that what was feeding them dried up. What was quenching their thirst dried up. Isn't that something? We can be doing things and we think we got it all together. But what happens when it starts to dry up? It reminds me of the times we're in now. Things are just drying up. I don't care what discipline you're in. Talk to the doctors, talk to the scientists, talk to the economists, talk to the politicians, talk to the preachers. All will say, surely to eradicate what's going on in our earth today, we need something new because what we have has dried up. It's no longer working. It's no longer healthy. It's no longer thriving. We need something new. I want you to note that in the midst of this drought, it didn't just impact those who was doing wrong, but those who was doing right also was impacted by it. There's a lot of people around right now saying, "Well, we don't understand. Well, why is it that those who are doing good are subjected to what's going on?" I want you to know that there are times when God says, "I'm going to get the whole world's attention. I'm going to get everybody's attention." Think about it. In this drought, not only was Ahab affected, Elijah was impacted, and all of the children of Israel. Ahab's leadership was dampened. Elijah was on the run and had to drink from the brook Cherith, and then the brook dried up. And then all of those others, they were impacted. A drought, think about it. They were impacted financially. They were impacted physically. They were impacted emotionally. They were all impacted. Didn't matter whether you were big or small.
Didn't matter what was going on. Everything was impacted. Everything suffered. Everything struggled. Everything wrestled. And so here it is now. They've had a taste of what it means to live without God. They've had a taste what it means to do things according to their own will and their own way. They've had a taste to see what man could do. And now God says, now I'm going to show you the right way. I'm going to show you what God can do. I'm going to show you what I can do. I'm about to flex my muscle. You said the God of Baal ruled the rain. I stopped up the heavens so that it would be no rain. But now I'm going to show you what I can do. And this is where we come to. In verse 41, I like this because it blesses me because God shows us that his grace is amazing. God shows us that he can shift things. He can change things. He can give us another chance. I like this. I like this because God now shows a comparison between him and everything else. And so here now in the passage where we are, it has been 3.5 years, and Elijah says, now it's time to declare something new. For 3.5 years, we've been going through. We've been wrestling with drought. We've been wrestling with issues, but now it's time for something new. I don't know if you can feel that. Just look around, and everybody's got to be declaring it's time for something new. And so he tells Ahab, he says, I hear the sound of rain, Ahab. I don't see it yet, but I can hear it. I hear it. And so the Bible says that he climbs up Mount Carmel. He climbs up and he crouches down and he places his head between his knees. Let me say it again, because I know some of you didn't get that. He climbs up Mount Carmel. Can you hear it? If I draw near to God, he'll draw near to me. He climbs up Mount Carmel. Faith come by hearing and hearing the word of God. He climbs up Mount Carmel. He's climbing. And the Bible says he crouches down and he places his head between his knees. Let me break that down for you. You see, in biblical days, they didn't have hospitals with stirrups. And so in biblical days, when a woman was about to give birth, when she was about to give birth to a child, she would crouch down and push. And so what the Bible is saying here is that the man of God, Elijah, he took the position of a pregnant woman. I don't know about you, but I need to birth something different than what I've had. It's time to birth something new. So Elijah took the position of a pregnant woman in labor. My God. James describes it as the effectual fervent prayer. He declares that this is earnest praying will avail of much. And so here it is. Elijah says, okay, for 3.5 years, we've been going through, but now I'm going to climb up because I hear the abundance of rain. There's a stirring in me that God is ready to birth something new. He climbs up Mount Carmel and he crouches. He puts his head between his knees and he begins to cry out to God. Understanding, I'm pregnant and I'm about to birth something. Oh, my Lord. He gets there now. He's there, and I was thinking about this the other day, how that there's a lot of people bowing down to things, a whole lot of people, but there's a difference from bowing down to the will of God and bowing down to other things. You see, when we bow down to other things, it's simply crouching sin. But when we bow down to God, what we're doing is gathering grace. Woo! My God, Lord, I'm pregnant. I know something new is supposed to happen. I'm bowed down that I might gather the grace to do what? To push this new thing out. I wonder if I have any witnesses that feel like it's time for something new. It's time. It's just time. It's time for something new in the church. It's time. It's time. It's something new in our nation. It's time for something new in our world. It's time. It's time. And what I got to do is I've got to gather grace. I'm getting on my knees to pray that I might push out that in which God has given me. I got to push through the darkness. I got to push through the pain. I've got to push through the opposition. I'm pregnant. I've got to push. It's not going to be easy, but I've gathered the grace that I might be able to push. Some of us, when you look at certain people that's bowing to other things, all it is what's motivating them to bow is nothing more than selfishness and worldly gain. But for the man and for the woman who says, I'm going to bow because I know God's going to give me grace to step into something new, to step into something powerful, to step into something divine, to step into something glorious, to step into something that the enemy can't defeat. It's time. It's time for something new. Cultural indifference to God will not work. Racism will not work. Lukewarm believers will not work. People dying prematurely to COVID-19 will not work. I'm going to bow down to God and birth something new. God, I want to see heaven here on earth. I want to see that in which you've declared before a time here on earth. God, I want to see. You've called me for a time such as this. I want to see your miracles here on earth. I want to see your power here on earth. But I'm going through and I'm struggling and I'm wrestling. But I remember the prophet Elijah. He crouched down and he gathered grace that he might be able to walk through it, that he might be able to stand in it, that he might be able to push back the darkness, that he might be able to push back fear, that he might be able to push back unbelief. I'm talking to somebody. It's time to bow again before an holy God, an awesome God who's more than enough. It's time. No more playing church. No more pretending to be a believer. We say one thing, but we walk another way. No, it's time for something new. It's time. We can't go back to the old. We can't go back to the familiar. We can't be lukewarm. The world needs the believer to stand up and be who God says we're to be. What does this look like? I know that's the question. What does this process look like? Because after all, we've gone down before. We've prayed before. We've prayed before, but I want you to see the whole picture. I want you to understand the kind of praying I'm talking about. I'm not just talking about bowing. I'm talking about I'm going down, connecting to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. I'm not talking about bowing so I can get God to just please me, satisfy me, give me what I want. I'm talking about connecting to the Lord who's more than enough. I'm talking about connecting to the God of the universe. I'm talking about connecting to the great I am. I'm talking about connecting to the God who says nothing is impossible with him. I'm talking about going down and gathering the benefits of heaven that we might stand and do what God has called us to do. What does it look like? What does it look like? In Romans 12, 12, let me just jump over there real quick. Jump over there real quick. In Romans 12, Paul outlines a number of things that should be a part of the Christian life. But I want to focus on what's said in verse 12. In verse 12. It's a brief verse, but just let me just read it. It says, rejoicing in hope, patient in tribulation, continuing steadfastly in prayer. Let me say it again. Rejoicing in hope, patient in tribulation, continuing steadfastly in prayer. What am I trying to say to you? What is it going to look like? We're going to go through things, but as a believer, the first thing I want you to note is that there ought to be a rejoicing in hope. Let me give this illustration. When a woman is pregnant and she's coming to about the end of the first trimester, that woman will go and tell everybody. What is she telling them? I'm expecting. When you rejoice and hope, what you start doing is living a life of expectancy. You're not walking around with your head down. You're walking around knowing you're carrying something. You don't know quite what the baby looks like, but you know you're carrying something. And you walk around, and after a while, the belly starts to poke out a little bit. And now it's evident to everybody who's looking at you, she's expecting something. That woman is expecting. She's expecting. We just ought not, as believers, walking around without hope. No, I'm expecting something. Before Elijah climbed Mount Carmel, he told Ahab, he said, go eat and drink because I hear the sound of rain. So before he could see it, he was expecting it. Why? Because he could hear it. He could hear it on the inside. He could hear it. Said, I hear the sound of rain. When a mother is expecting, so now not only can everybody start to see it after time is moving on, that mother just starts to prepare, right? She starts to prepare. She'll go and have the room painted. She'll tell her husband, honey, we need to buy some new furniture. And she'll go to the store and get some new clothes. She starts preparing because she's expecting. If I spent some time with you, could I tell you were expecting? I know what you're saying. Leave me alone, Pastor. If I was in your presence, could I hear by your speech that you were expecting? Could I see it in your worship that you're expecting something? I just wonder if I spent a little bit of time with you, could I tell you were expecting? Elijah was expecting a release from heaven here on earth. I can't continue to walk through life as if everything is the same. I've got to be ready to move beyond the old to birth something new. And some of us, let me just say this, some of us have settled for patching up the old. No. When a mother is expecting, she knows there's no patchwork. What she's about to deliver is something totally new. There is no patching up. I get upset when I see people refusing to move from the old. I get upset when I see people just trying to put a new name on an old thing. I get upset when I see people that's just trying to make it through, hoping that no one is looking, hoping that they can just make it through. Listen, the dangers of patching up the old, if you're not careful, you'll abort future dreams. You'll miss out on new levels of ministry. And you'll miss out on new opportunities of experiencing God and impacting our world. Why? Because you refuse to leave the old. Well, be careful. I don't know about you. I realize that there are some people, they're not going to move. They're going to keep looking back. Never able to go forward, never able to get what God has for them because they keep looking back. But I come to tell you, there's nothing for you back there. It's time to go forth with something new. It's time to go forth with something greater. It's time to go forth to declare the power of God in a new dimension and a new measure. Stop looking back and make up your mind, I'm going forward. And so, you said, okay, I got you. I got to walk around like I'm expecting. I've got to declare it. I got to walk in it. But what about the pain I'm feeling? What about this pain that's going on in our world? Talk to me about the pain. Talk to me about the suffering. The second thing we read in Romans, Paul tells us we must be patient in tribulation. You say, well, what are you talking about? It is often in the crucible of pain and crisis that something new can be birthed, okay? Recessions have been birthed, or the birthing place of some companies that identified a need and became innovative in the midst of a crisis. A mother's body is in crisis right before she's about to give birth. She can be in pain. She can desire that pain to go away. But how many of you realize that it is not her will or her timetable, but that baby has been assigned a date? Let me say it again. I don't care how fast you want a thing to happen. I don't care how much you cry. What I need you to understand that there is an assignment that's in you. God has assigned that assignment with a date. And what you've got to do is say, God, I'm going to keep on praying until the assigned date comes to pass. The assigned date comes to pass. You said, well, when did Elijah do that? Well, let's go back to the story. Elijah told his servant, go up now and look toward the sea. He said, all right, go up. Let's note that first thing. Go up now. In other words, get up from where you are. Woo! Go up now. Elijah was crouching, but he told his servant, I want you to see the comparison. I want you to see Elijah, and I want you to see what he's speaking to his servant. Elijah was praying. He had already started to shift in his praying. When he went low, he had already got up from where he was. When he climbed up Mount Carmel, he had already got up from where he was. He says to his servant, get up from where you are. I come to tell you, I need you to get up from where you are. Get up from self-pity. Get up from your issues. Get up for saying nothing will change. Get up from your fear. Get up from your doubt. Get up and go up and look towards the sea. And so he does it, and the Bible says he gets up and he goes and he comes back, and Elijah says, okay, what did you see? He said, nothing. Elijah says, go back again. I believe Elijah was saying in himself, because he had already said he heard the abundance of rain, I believe what Elijah was saying is that while he was down there, no, you don't see anything yet. You said you see nothing. Elijah says, add the yet. We've got to let that be the confession of our faith. I might not see it now. I'm going to change it. I just don't see it yet. That's what my confession is. I just don't see it yet. It's on the way. But I've got to be patient in tribulation. Go back again. If God spoke it, surely it will come to pass. Go back again. And the Bible says he did it six times. He did it six times. And he came back, and on the seventh time, he said, I see a cloud the size of a man's hand. I'm going to try to move past this kind of quick. But this is good right here. He came back. He said, listen here, Elijah. He says, I see a cloud, but it's just the size of a man's hand. Mm-hmm. A man's hand. The problem with the servant was he compared the size to a man's hand. Mm-hmm. He compared the size of cloud to a man's hand. How often do we compare what we see to what man has? Oh my gosh. Okay. All right. You still didn't get it. I'm gonna be patient with it. But Elijah, the difference with him was when he said, I see the cloud, when his servant said, I see the cloud the size of a man's hand, he says, get up and run. Go tell Ahab that I hear an abundance of rain is coming now, and he better hurry. He tells him, see, what the difference was, Elijah, the prophet of God, he saw the content of the cloud. His servant compared it to a man's hand, but Elijah compared the content to what was in God's hands. Oh, my God, you still don't don't get it. I'm going to help you. You see, do you remember when there was 5,000 and they were 5,000 that were hungry and needed to be fed? If you look in the Gospel of John, you'll find all of these people were hungry. All of these people needed to be fed. And there was the apostles there, the disciples there. And they said, well, we don't have enough to feed them. And Jesus said, well, what do we have? And one of the disciples says, there's a little boy and he has 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. And then in the boy's hand, it was only 5 loaves, 2 fish. But in God's hand, when they put it in Jesus' hands, my God, it fed the 5,000. It was more than enough. This is what I'm trying to tell you. Many of us have been relying on what's in man's hands. But when we start looking at the content of what was in the cloud, we realize that what we're after is what's in the hands of God. Man will always only be able to give us a limited amount, but with God, it's unlimited. To the servant, it appeared to be a small thing. Ooh, but the content of that cloud, honey, was more than enough. It was an abundance that was coming. There was a deluge that was coming. Something new was about to be birthed. I come to tell you, stop comparing things. Stop looking for things that are in the hands of man and begin seeking God for what's in his hands. Oh, Lord, glory be to God. Don't know about you, but I want the content of the cloud, the miracle in the cloud, the deliverance that's in the cloud, the power that's in the cloud. Oh, my God, I'm going to put it in your hands. That's what I'm looking for. Why am I crouching low? Because I want what's in the cloud to be released upon me. And then the last piece, continue steadfast in prayer. Remain earnest in prayer. I come to tell you that the intensity of the pressure we feel now during this difficult time is not meant to be tolerated, but channeled through prayer. What kind of prayer? Prevailing prayer. The kind of prayer that will unleash something new from heaven on earth. Allow me to just close with Isaiah 43:19. God is up to something, and it's not the old thing. He's ready to birth something new. I believe he's allowed disruption to take place that he might be able to birth something new. Isaiah 43:19 puts it this way, behold, I will do a new thing. Now it shall spring forth. Shall you not know it? I will even make a road in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. Where there is no road, God said, I'll make one. What I'm about to do, shall you not know it? You're going to know it's me. You're going to know it that it's not man's doing. You're going to know it that it's from the God above. God says, I'm going to do it. Places where there are no roads, places where there are no rivers, I'm going to create it and I'm going to flow. And it will be an abundance more than enough. Let's pray. Lord, I thank you for your people. Bless them. For those who do not know you, for those who've been suffering and struggling, for those who are overwhelmed, I pray that this is a new day that every man and woman would bow once again in a new fashion. Lord, that we would bow before you, that we would cry out to you, that we would turn to you, that, Lord, that we would look to you like never before. This is the season. This is the hour. Awaken us, revive us, renew us. Lord, I thank you that souls coming into the kingdom. And for those that don't know you, I pray that this is the day that they cry out to you now and they cry out and ask you to be the savior of their life. They've done it their own way, but this is the day now that they give their hearts unto you. And so, God, I thank you. Bless your people. Touch your people. and draw us unto you once again. And I thank you for that. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you.
This is Apostle Brian Attinson. We serve a covenant-keeping God. The Bible tells us in Malachi chapter 3 that God will open up the windows of heaven when his people give. It also tells us that God will rebuke the devourer on our behalf. We are praying for God's blessing over your life, and I want to encourage you to give and be faithful to the Lord. There are three ways in which you can give, either by mail, PayPal, or text by giving. God bless you, and we can't wait to see you again soon.
Thank you for joining us today. I pray you were strengthened and encouraged by today's message. We serve a God who is able to do the impossible. And as you continue to seek him, he will surely answer and meet your every need. Call on his name, believe that he is able, and see what he will do for you. God bless you. See you soon.